Good evening, friends. So today is the third session of webinar series on the novel Misplaced Heads, written by Jayanthi Shankar, which is me. I've taken the role of Dhanya today because she's speaking today, and from next week she will retake the moderation. And today we will begin with something that I want to share with you all. It's a piece of development for the novel. Last week, I got an email from, the veteran dancer, Dhananjayan. And you all must be knowing Dhananjayan and Shanta Dhananjayan, right? He had emailed me that Dr. Radhika Surajit had given him a copy of the novel. So, and he's going to read it. That's an honor by itself, isn't it? So that's good news to share now. And then coming to this last week's session, Radhika Surajit and Gautam Sashidharan, they did a fantastic job, and the interaction was superb for us, it was memorable in the sense we covered everything, both in those two topics and even out of those two topics. And I learned something watching those two videos, I must admit, that I have been speaking looking at your faces on the screen. I'm supposed to look at the camera and speak. And this is the thing I learned after those two videos. Well, learning is endless. And so now, coming to today's session, let's not wait. I'm going to invite Dhanya to speak on a depiction of history and storytelling in Misplaced Heads. I look forward to listening to what she has to say. So Dhanya is I have to read it, isn't it? Otherwise, I can't. Dhanya is a food technologist and a psychotherapist with a lifetime goal to establish a non-profit organization that provides quality nutrition and education to mentally and physically challenged kids. She is presently the CPO of Neolith Foods Private Limited, Thane. Her flair for English language and inspiration from works of Dan Brown, Jeffrey Archer, and Amish Tripathi nudged her to try her hand in fiction. Her two unpublished novels, The Core and The Ugly Duckling, strive to shout out her love for the two worlds, literature and science. She wishes to publish her books and widen the horizons of the Indian youth beyond the young adult fiction. Before we go on to, to Dhanya, I forgot to add one small piece of information. Mr. P. Muralidharan and Mrs. Muralidharan, they know Dr. Radhika Surajit, and he was the one who actually told me to contact her months back, about 10 months back, and then it was all unfolding, so many good things happening to the book. Now over to Dhanya. Dhanya, please take over.
Good evening, everybody. And today my topic is about how history is depicted in the novel. When Auntie had given me this topic, I had to go through a few, online articles and all about the Devadasi system, but I couldn't find anything concrete. There was no formal documentation of the system as it is. So what I did was I called her and asked her, where did you find all this information that you have given in the book? How did you find all this? Which books did you read? And I was and she was telling me a few informal documents, like there were journals of like the ancient and the medieval authors, like Abul Fazl and the other authors, and on all that, and from the Ibn Battuta's Moroccan diaries and all, from that she had taken parts of it, and she had like she has incorporated them in the novel. And then I asked her, can you please share the research? Can you at least share the part of the research which you have used, so that I will know if how you have depicted the actual research in the book? And then she shared a few files with me, and I had to go through it. You guys won't believe the mail that she sent me was 8 pages of just, these were history notes. Like, she had taken parts of the book, like the lines that had spoken about Devadasi system from each book, from each author, she had written like three lines, like maybe like a paragraph per author, and the entire compilation was 8 pages. So she had read so many books to even find such material. And I was so inspired by it. And as I had spoken last week when we were talking also, to me, as I also study history in the side for my education. And while I used to study history, I was not much interested. Like, the system is not much documented at all, like in through the medieval, ancient, or the the contemporary times. And when I read Auntie's book and I went back to my books, I could find subtle notes of this, not very obviously written, but very subtly written. And through the comparison of my books and Misplaced Heads, I could form a picture of the actual system of the Devadasi history. And this is just how I interpreted the history must have been. Like, all historians are interpreters, right? No one knows what happened. They just have interpreted their own, like what they saw, they interpreted it. And I think Misplaced Heads goes beyond interpreting it, and it gives us so much of information, authentic information. So how this system formed, from all the research that Auntie has done, and from my personal research, I have come to know that in the ancient times, when the system actually started, that is before 7th century AD, before that, in the ancient times, what has happened is that those were not times where anything was hereditary. Almost all of India was democratic, where the people had to, they elected their own kings, and they were small tribes around the forests, and they had to elect their own king. And election doesn't normally mean like you have to vote, but the person whoever is stronger will be the king of that clan. And that is how it used to be. And at those times, temples were not built much. People used to worship nature as it is, like the mountain people used to worship mountains, the people in the sea used to worship the sea, and all that. And once the medieval times came into picture, then what happened? Everything became hereditary. Like, kings wanted their sons to be kings. They didn't want like a random man who was stronger than them to become a king. They wanted a prince who has always lived in luxury from his young age to become the next king. So that is only then kings started building temples. They started, patronizing certain art forms to carry on not just the name and the faith of the god, but also the name and the faith of themselves. Like, the king's name also was carried on through the temple system and the art forms. So that is when this Devadasi system has come into picture. And when it started, it was not started as a system where the Devadasi women used to, they used to give birth to their own children, and those children will become Devadasis. But when it started, it was a system where people looked at this, at it as more of a spiritual institution than an art form. To them, giving up their girl child to the temple was like a sacrifice, like how you give up your, like how we now sacrifice like a hen or a goat to God. It was like a sacrifice that the family was doing for the greater good. It started like that, Then some people had given up their daughters because they weren't able to fend for them. Like they were too poor to, you know, marry off a daughter. So they had to give the daughter up to the temple. And that is how it started. It started as a means of either a spiritual institution or as a place where people, the weaker section could also be part of the mainstream by giving up their daughter. Then once I think, like the kings, the Devdasi, all Devdasis also wanted to have their own children in the system. You know, like they also wanted their children, not just like some child from somewhere that they would train and just make them dancers. They maybe thought, you know, why don't I have my own child? Because it will still have the dance in its genes, right? It will be easier for them to train their own child than to train a random stranger. So they started this system of giving birth to children and training them for the next generation of dancers. And when this happened is when the system must have, there is a chance of it to have gotten corrupted or for it to have taken a different meaning from the spirituality. Because once a woman, in India usually once a, before that, these dancers were just like virgins who were given up to God. Now when these people have children, Indians, in the formal Indian society, a woman's purity or chastity, as they call it, is lost once she has her own child. So that is when they stopped looking at her as God's slave and started looking at the Devdasis as someone who were just dancers. You know, they had degraded from being God's slaves to just dancers. Their art form just became an art form and not a rendition to God itself. So at that second stage, obviously they need to have a man to give birth to the children. So what they like usually how we breed, like, you know, how we breed like animals now, you know, for pasture or for better milk or for better eggs, they would find the man with strong qualities that they want for their children, and they would breed with them and they would have children. And it was taught to them that they should not have any emotional connections with the man, right? Which obviously, once you have had a connection, it is hard for them to resist to have an emotional connection with the man. So that must have transgressed, and there must have been a time where though they were merrily rich and they were not dependent on the man for their livelihood, they still wanted that connection, that physical or emotional connection. And finally, when the Britishers came to India, this part of research was very explicitly given in Misplaced Heads. There are two places where the rulers have changed the system. One is during the Mughal era, and the other is during the English era, like the British era. Before that, when the Cholas or when the Pandyas were taking care of the system, these women were looked at as art forms, though they were looked at as just dancers. They still were left in the temple. They were not brought to palaces. But once the Mughals came up and they took up all they had to, I mean, most of India was ruled based on faith, you know, than on territory. When the Mughals came up and they had to spread Islam, they had to demolish our temples. And where will these women go? They didn't know anything to do than to dance at temples. So the Mughals should have taken them to their palaces and made them their concubines, and they should have left, like, you know, these women were like Radhika ma'am said that they had become from Devadasis, they have transitioned into becoming Rajadasis. Rajadasis are people who are slaves of the king. And if you go into Indian history and read a little bit about the art and culture of India, there is this one dance form. It's Kathak. Kathak is basically a dance form which is a mix of the Indian traditional dance form and the Persian dance form. So that is the only dance form which is a mixture of the both. So this must have come up only if these women were staying in the palaces. You cannot go teach a woman a different form of dance if she's staying in a temple or if she's controlled by a different system. So this must have come up then. And these women were started, taken up as for their just their looks. Now the art also had lost its value, and these women, and they were bare bodied. If you had read Misplaced Heads, you would have understood that their top half was naked. So they were bare bodied, and they were prized more for their looks than even the art form. Then came the English era, where in the English period, in the not just the English, not just the Britishers, but the entire of Europe, they have always looked at Indians as uncivilized. For them, anyone who is not clothed, who is not speaking a proper language, who doesn't follow particular rules of civilization, is uncivilized. So when these men came here, they looked at these women walking bare-bodied. They wanted to cover them up. They wanted them not to be free. This was, though this is looked at as just, you know, making us more civilized, it was their way of not just stopping our freedom, but it is a way of you know, restricting a woman's free will. It is hiding her in a shield so that she will not be empowered anymore. And because before that, if you look at all the Indian temples also, all our temples have statues of bare-bodied women. Now, none of the temples have women who are fully clothed. We don't have women who wear frocks. We don't have women who wear full saris. Even if she's wearing a sari, she will not wear a blouse. Even if the statue is wearing a sari, it will not have a blouse. And if you look at temples, especially in the Chola time temples, you can see that. You can see the statues being, and all of us think, you know, these are people, these are gods, these are we might have, and I'm very sure that most of these sculptors would have used these women as their inspirations, or like as their models to make these sculptures, because all the sculptures would not look the same, and they had to look at something, right, to make a sculpture. And these women must have served that purpose. And once the Britishers came in, they did everything that they could to change our way of life. That is when the tribes lost their forest rights. That is because these women were, you know, they were guarding the temple lands, and they were guarding a huge part of the temple's, assets. They were owning the jewels of the temple. So if the Britishers had to tap into that assets, they just had to abolish the system. That's all they had to do. If you just take off the administrator, then who's going to take responsibility for that property? And look at our temple lands now. Most of it are, they're all public properties. Not much of it are left to the temples. So they have taken it upon themselves, and they have used those lands. And that is when the system has completely come to an end, from a spiritual institution to an art form, to just, you know, mere women becoming objects of pleasure, to becoming divines, to finally being called prostitutes. These women, the particular Devadasi system has gone through so many stages in history, and every stage of this has been mentioned in Misplaced Heads. All five stages, because if you see in Nakan's life, you would have read that how Nakan was the top of the, you know, society. You know, how people used to respect her, how people used to love what she was doing, and all that. And then in the second part, there is a conversation between two women, where there is a conversation between a man and a woman, where the man looks at these women and admires their art form. And in the third part, there is a part where these temple women will start having feelings for a man that with whom she has had a child with. And there is a part where these women are just looked at for their looks. And there is a beautiful connection that Jayanti ma'am has brought in. She has said that there is a connection between the Roman culture of women leading a temple and Indian system of Devadasis. There is a high possibility of this, because Roman trade with India started in 4th century AD. So there's a high chance, because this system started only at the 7th century. So there's a high chance of this being true. And when the horses are not indigenous Indian animals, they were brought in from Rome, like Bactria. There is a part of Iran, which is called Mesopotamia, and Iraq, which is called Bactria.
I'm sorry, there's something, it went off and I'm reconnecting.
No,
you continue talking, Danya.
Yeah. No, let the others join, it's okay.
Yes.
Am I taking too long?
No. Just enjoy talking. We're all listening and we're thoroughly researched. Thank you.
Very mesmerizing, your account is. Yeah,
please continue, Danya.
Absolutely floored by the line that you have created for us to follow, and it's beautiful. Thank you.
Restart.
Thank you. Yeah. So this transition is beautifully given, and see, there was this one part in the book which convinced me completely that there is a connection between Rome and India. If you look at Roman sculptures, even if they are in the stadium of that famous stadium of Rome or anything, right? So those were also half naked women. They are also not fully clothed women. You look at them, they'll also be draped in a cloth. That's what they will also be draped in. It will not look like exactly like a sari, like draped like a sari, but they'll also, it's called a tonga. But it's still a cloth. It's still a piece of cloth which they are draped in. And they will also be standing in that. If you look at Bharatanatyam, there is a posture called Tribhanga. Tribhanga is, I'm sure Radhika ma'am would have explained it better. But Tribhanga is where there are three cuts in your body. Like there is a slant here, and there is a slant in your hip, and there's a slant in your knee. So Tribhanga, three angas are bent. So this Tribhanga, if you look at most of the Roman sculptures, you will see that in men also. When men stand also, they will stand like that. You know, all these three cuts will be there. So there is a high possibility that there is a connection between the Roman system of letting women administer the temples and Indian Devadasi system. But I'm sure that their system had not been vulgarized so much, and the system had not been made so, you know, looked down upon. There was a controversy in India even last year when Mr. Vairamuthu had come to Andal. Andal temple is like a temple in Sriliputur. And Mr. Vairamuthu, he is a very famous Indian lyricist and a poet. He was brought to Andal temple for a speech, and he was giving a speech, and he just mentioned Andal is one of the Alvars of Vishnu. She is one of the most prized Alvar, like the one of the women Alvar. So he said Andal was a Devadasi, and so much of controversy erupted after that. He was scrutinized for it, and the media was, it went haywire. He might have just meant the literal meaning of the word. And if she was an Alvar, if she was a slave of God, Devadasi means a slave of God. It doesn't have to mean what it finally meant. That is not the actual system, right? There are so many legislations brought up in every country. There are so many things that are brought up with a different intention, with something very, very different intended. And it ends up being something else that doesn't take the sanctity of the actual institution. So this is what we have brought the system down to. We have brought it down to being a spiritual institution, to being called, you know, an institution of prostitution. So this is very, very, it has been brought in and misplaced like ever before. I'm sure that even if someone had written a non-fictional book about Devadasi system also, none of us would have picked it up and read it as much as we have read this. And it would not have given us this proper, chain of events. And even chronology is, though the chronology is not given, like it's not said this year this happened, this year this happened. There are parts where the chronology comes in the book. But the beauty of it is that a system will not change overnight. You cannot say the system started in 7th century, it changed in 8th century. It will, because the Mughals ruled us from the 8th century AD till the 16th century AD. We don't know in which part of the Mughal and which king of the Mughal Empire changed the system. So no one can say who did this and who did that. And there is no documentation of it. And the English, obviously, they would have documented what all they did with the temple lands, but they definitely would not have documented about this, because this is what they did for their own profit, right? I mean, they're not going to document it in their archives. So we will not find any information about it in any non-fictional book. I just applaud Jayanti ma'am for having, done so much. I seriously cannot go into so much research for anything, leave alone to write a book for anything. Even for studying, I don't think I will go up for so much research. And for her to read so many books, for her to, I don't know, I can't even comprehend how she has done all this. And to bring it in a way that all of us don't get, if what I just spoke was written as a book, we wouldn't have read it through. We would have stopped at half the book, and we would have, why would we care what happened to the system, right? So she gave life to it by bringing in emotions to each of these stages. When there are two people speaking and their pain is shown through emotions, rather than just a chronological, a table of what happened, it made the learning more fun. For me, it felt like I was reading my history book with the stories of the people in it. That's all it felt like to me. It didn't feel like I was reading something completely fictitious, something completely spun out of air. It didn't feel like that to me when I read Misplaced Head. It felt like a teacher's beautiful way of showing her students that the subject is more beautiful than what we think it is. And it felt so, because I'm a woman, I'm able to connect to it and emote with every feeling that they had. I'm not sure, maybe men will have other thoughts to talk about. And the beauty in it was the contemporary line, the contemporary thread that she had brought in. When she had introduced, though the entire story is revolving around Purna, I have not even spoken about her. And that is the beauty of the book. She wants us not to just see what she shows us. She wants us to read between the lines, understand beyond what she is showing us. And Purna, though she is a present age woman, though she is in her mid 50s, there is, her life goes through the same of these stages of this Devadasi system. If you look at her in the first part of the book, she's looked at as just a dancer, a beautiful dancer, Then she loses her parents and she gets married. Now she has gotten all those emotions of a woman. She has become that emotional character. And then when she meets this Raghu, she goes into this transition where I don't want to call her a prostitute or a concubine, but where her sexual feelings are brought out. So this is how the book not just connects with the Devadasi system. It's Devadasi system, like mentioned in the book, it's not just the time period. It is, you can even call it the stages in Purna's life here. That is what I felt. That is what I felt from reading Misplaced Heads. And I hope all of you got what I wanted to tell you. And I hope I didn't bore you all. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So, thoroughly researched. It feels so happy to have a reader in Danya. Honored. Thank you, Danya. Now, over to our next speaker, Usha Nagaswamy, has been writing on and off since school days and has not been able to fully indulge in her craving to write or translate until recently. She is a further education lecturer in London and has done a lot of interpreting and translating as a freelancer for the local Tamil community. It has been her pleasure, she says, to be a small part of Jayanti Shankar's creative writing, translating a selected set of stories for Laws and Laws, and then also for the pages of Facebook. And the experience is an attestation of the success and richness of Jayanti Shankar's stories, she feels. So let's welcome Usha Nagaswamy to, tell us what she feels about the feminism depicted in Misplaced Heads. Over to Usha.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. And I really cannot follow that young speaker who just awed us and inspired us with that very crystal clear message of what she has gleaned from. She was applauding Jayanti Shankar's research techniques, and I think I applaud your technique, how well you have observed and you have given the line in our heads. And I have noticed the first part of it, but I did not relate this part of Purna's life being the reflection of the same lineage. And that was amazing. And the timeline that you drew in our heads is going to stay. I think I'm going to look at it in depth, in different way. That is what this webinar has done. I think many might wonder, what kind of a webinar is that you have to talk so much about the same book over and over again? But I think it's an amazing tool that has put together some really fantastic angles, perspectives. So if there is something so beautiful, it has to be looked at from different angles. So you may miss some facets of it just looking at one angle. And if I read it, it's my experience. When I listen to, other speakers, I have been listening to the webinars. They were quite intense. And I think of all the speakers, I'm partial to Dhanya in her presentation of the facts. Anyway, without taking much more time, expressing I was so emotional. I was so close to tears when you talked about Purna's life. And I can feel it as a woman. What is feminism today? Feminist is a person who can recognize the equality and the full humanity of men and women. This is what feminism, and according to me, feminism is not about just giving the women a lift up and trying to make them more powerful or more aggressive or harshly outspoken. You can be outspoken, but there is an edge to feminism of today, which is a bit sad to see with the younger women, because the younger women are trying to find their feet and trying to rise up above the oppression of all these years. And that is what you see in the characters of Dhanya, you are on my lips now. Tanya is struggling there, and she is forceful, she is angry, she is emotional, she is outspoken, and same with Purna also. There are so many emotions that come out of this female heroes who, they are the central figure herself, even though she comes across as sort of docile, a little bit submissive person in her text in some of the stages. And sometimes I was just thinking, oh my God, what kind of a woman are you? Because let me take, you know, me back to my own upbringing. I am a very vocal, vociferous, extrovert, and I speak my mind so much and so strongly. Whereas I have another feminist who I grew up with, my sister, who is the softer, gentle, quiet, yet a feminist at heart through and through. And she's been an amazing inspiration in all my life. So it can, different types of feminism. So actually I'm so happy to see the softer feminist that I was talking about, who's more grounded than me. I was this, you know, really up and high. So that's my sister. So she's becoming a little bit more vocal, and through her books, and even there, she's very subtle, very, very, my sister Jayanti Shankar, I'm very proud to say at this point, maybe I shouldn't, I let the cat out of the bag, but my type of feminism, I'm taking a softer dip. So in this book, what I really caught my eye was that all through the book, as usual, she hasn't expressed her views, and the characters are so fully rounded and perfectly shaped that they speak, their conversations, their way of approaching emotions, that speaks for itself. She hasn't given us her inner feelings, but we can understand this feminist is there through and through. And I was a bit upset with Poorna's psychological degradation when Raghu's life, you know, he makes the decision to desert her, and how she's thrown out of sorts, and that really threw me. And that is where I was thinking, is she this lady? But actually, Poorna, in her own way, is also a feminist. She had a tough life, lost her parents, and she stood up for her art. And she had this one single point, you know, a yogi is supposed to have that single one-pointed focus, which is what I see in Poorna. She has devoted herself to this art form and single-pointed focus, and she has been training true to the art, and her performances and everything. She has just devoted herself only to the art. And there is still yet underneath that a skillful artisan, there is that woman. When it comes to that woman, that is where the feminism kicks in. And there she is trying to love and be loved and to express love. And she does take few bold steps to express it. And her emotional need and her craving to become a mother, the dream scene where she, you know, the Poorna suffers the pangs of becoming a mother, that, and all the, even through the mental depression, there are these flashes of that woman coming through. And I think that for me speaks a lot about being a woman, being a feminist, being a woman, to express yourself as a female. And I was just going to read one line which caught my eye towards the epilogue. There are some poetic lines of Jayanti. She says about Carl, she says, time, a male or female, perhaps just a wheel, to revolve endlessly, dark and mysterious, sternly disciplined, and moving forward, conquering anything and everything, and destroying perilous. So, I mean, I'm not going to give the whole poem, and that color, an inanimate or non, it's just an abstract idea, the idea of time, it's so elastic, and just how Jayanti has transformed that. Is it male or female? And I wondered myself, I asked that question. And in all of the struggles of Poorna and Tanya, you can see Tanya is the more stronger feminist among them. So the true feminist is someone who values themselves, who's going to stand up for themselves and their emotions and their needs. And I think Tanya does that very, very strongly, very well, because she makes a clear cut, and she's very disappointed in Rishi's betrayal. And it's very, very sad to see. It's a rude awakening for her to know that this guy who admired her so much is now capable of such deceit and dishonesty, which just takes away all the love and everything, and her slate is wiped clean and she just shaves her head in a sort of rebellion. I read about Queen Elizabeth when she was so frustrated that everybody is trying to marry her off to this one or that one. So she was a true feminist. She said, okay, I'm married to my country. And so she shaves her head, makes herself, you know, paints herself with white things just to disfigure herself, to be less attractive to the men. So that is exactly what Tanya does. And so feminism has many forms, many shapes, many ways of manifesting itself. And in throughout this story, be it in Nakhan, where she is actually the leader, empowering, a feminist is supposed to empower women, and she empowers others to become good dancers. And even her daughter, who's another generation, and there are, as Tanya said, there is the physical coming in and the you know, little bits of relationships, all these things. Even there, the woman, she is making the choice. She's saying, this is the man I want. I'm going to have him. And I'm going to have him for this clear purpose. And that's it. And there is no need to, you know, be too mushy about things. And that takes a lot of courage. That's what many girls are doing today. I just want to a child. So I can just, you know, it is sad that we are using men to impregnate us and to create our offsprings. That's it. But sometimes, you know, we have been treated entirely for centuries and centuries and generations. And the woman, the suppressed feminine, is trying to break free. And in that, you can see, you know, how the Devadas took the law. They were empowered women. They were not subjected to the social, the traumas of today's crazy social conditioning, which has messed us up. Through the Mughal life perspective, through the British perspective, it's just gone crazy, you know, taking us down a path of destruction. Now we're trying to, you know, we've been doing the seesaw dance of, you know, is this good, is this good, is this good? Even now, the Indian or the Asian women, they are still, or even the Western woman. We think the Western is completely liberated, they are free, they're not. So feminists, all we all have our work cut out, because we have to stand steady here, not sway this way or that or become harsh. So I think Misplaced Heads brings this aspect of feminism in a very beautiful way. There's no harsh tones anywhere, and the psychological, emotional traumas that a woman has to go through to find the right path, to stay stable and to be grounded, to be focused, at the same time be true to her own needs, and you know, her own, be it an ego need or an emotional need or a love need, whatever the need may be, she has to be true to herself. That is where the feminism shines through in this book, and I think it is very, very beautiful. Even though Purna is sort of brought to her rock bottom, she's hit rock bottom and she's become mentally depressed and complete, but there is the last note of possible hope that she picks up the book, and there is that really touched my heart, that okay, possibly there is redemption after all for her to find herself yet again. You know, you lose yourself in the traumas of life and then you have to rebuild yourself. This has happened to women over and over again. And in my personal life also, I have been broken down and I rebuild myself. I've broken down, rebuild. And that is in that journey, I have learned so much about human nature and other people's needs. And, you know, I'm getting more aware and we are learning every day, as we are learning constantly. So this book is, it is so monumental because it deals with emotions, human emotions, in such subtle and delicate and very dignified, not in the face kind of a thing. It's so delicate, so beautiful. It's blossomed into what it is. And most of the things, when I heard my sister talk about her research a little bit, and that time I used to think, oh my God, it's going to be a beautiful book, and I expected much from it. And this did not disappoint me at all, because it's a non-linear style, which is very unique in its way. There are non-linear books I have read, but that is not like, this is like a beautiful puzzle, little pieces of it coming together, every emotion touching another one and another one. And amidst this, coincidentally, all these females are bringing together this feminine energy of feminism. And I think that kind of feminism will touch and inspire women across the globe. I have no doubt. When I say across the globe, it's because it is in English and everybody is going to read it. I'm so excited about it. And there's so much we can go on. And I've got so many notes, and I've just got... she deals with romance, and she deals with extramarital affairs. She deals with taboo topics like homosexuality. And everything is done with such finesse and grace. I'm yet to read something so delicate, as it is so delicate, because beautiful things are subtle and you can't grasp it, but you can feel it. When you can feel it with your heart, when she speaks from the heart, we hear it and it hits us, and it strikes certain chords in us, which you know, just leaves you really thinking about it for a long time. And feminism doesn't have to be in the face. That is what is the message I get from here. And there are varying shades, you know, the shades. Some of them are very gentle, some are stark, as real life is very stark. Some of them are very, and some are very, like, sadly compliant, like in Purna's case. And the role reversal also, Raghu and Meena plays. Meena is another interesting character. She is strong, she's empowered, she's a go-getter, she gets a breadwinner, but she's showing us, Jayanti holds up the mirror and shows us, look, this kind of angle to a woman also exists. And it is a negative side of the feminism that I've been talking about earlier. And the emotional, psychologically, how she abuses Raghu and how he is also a victim. Even though as I am angry that he's treated her, Purna, this way, but he himself is a victim. A victim can only victimize another person. So the abuser becomes the abused. That is a very... thing that you can see in that. And and the feminist views of the writer glints very suggestively, very gently, and it just comes across. And there is a certain unspoken criticism that I see throughout in her depiction of the men. For example, Raghu, he's so indecisive, very demanding, very possessive, hopelessly romantic too, but cold and cunning when it comes to that. And he's different from Rishi in that way, that Rishi, yes, he promises the sun and the moon and the earth and everything in between, and then goes around, goes behind Tanya's back and betrays her so brutally with his child, you know. And Tarun, again, another character, he's a female, a very weaker male reflection of today's youth, who don't have much control over their self-discipline or control over their finances, who are dependent on the women. This is a recurrent story we hear, unfortunately, in today's world, but because girls are go-getters these days. I mean, much more so than the boys. I mean, I'm not generalizing. There are always exceptions and great, but we always talk about these women coming through the glass ceiling, breaking through. Why? Because they have broken through, you know, the barriers, and they're rising above the odds, which are very tough to rise above, which is what Tanya tries to do, which is what Purna tries to do. These are women who are trying to break out of the norm and break out of their shell and empower themselves and express themselves strongly. We do talk about, you know, but much of this rest of the population is under the ceiling, you know, yet to break through and yet to be empowered. So it's not just a story. It's a story of human beings. It's a story of a woman, I think. Unconsciously, it's the feminine power, empowerment that comes across. And yes, I think I have said as much as I wanted. I have this so much more. I can go on and on, you know. But I think I need to stop and allow others to have some time to ask their questions and have some discussion interactively.
Thank you, Usha. That was brilliant. That was equally, both of you, you know, more or less. So, and you told me you had questions to begin the interaction. So you can begin if you wish, or even Danya can start.
Yeah. I mean, do you want to go, Danya? You can go first if you want.
You can ask. I'll ask later.
So, Purna's own inner battles reflect her insecurities, okay? And her need to be loved and her inability to get Raghu's love. Why did you cast her in that? I mean, there is a little bit of me which disagrees with something, you know? If somebody who has built herself so much up, for her to be so submissive and paying second fiddle to Raghu, that didn't sit very well with me. Do you want to say something about that?
Yeah, sure. you know, Tanya character was initially my protagonist, I must say. Or inside me, I am more of Tanya. I have already told in the last session.
Yeah.
So Purna, I mean, as she went on building as a character, she was moving forward. It happened that way. I needed her to be like that. Or I can say because she was like that, I had to have Tanya as the complementary character. Yes, mid-50s. Purna is a mid-50s woman. She's not a young woman, mature. Yet she did that. I mean, she thought she can trust Raghu, or she thought Raghu is one person that who can father her child. She believed him so much. She loved him so much. The second side, the other side, Tanya also believed in Rishi. She's also, like you said, the same word, empowered woman, very strong. Both of them in their own ways, they are strong at heart. But we have seen many people, men and women, who are very strong-willed, very clear-minded. They will be very proper in every step they take all their lives. Yet, there will be once or twice they will have something they would do that for us from outside. How can she be doing that? We will think. Is it even possible for her to do that? Is it even possible for her to think like that? That's what is human. We are not properly programmed robots, or we're all humans. We do make mistakes, and I think characters, when they are humans, they are so humans that they are. They do mistakes, or as in they do something and they may regret a little. Those are part of human life. And if Purna and Tanya are so flesh and blood, so organic for the readers, then it's because they are humans, because they are doing certain things that are not expected from them. People are able to connect with those characters. Imagine if they both are idealistically, proper till the end. Then there's no novel. There's no story.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, And she read the poem, the end of the book. That's my first ever attempt at a poem. And
I think a couple of them, Mr. P. Muralidharan
will be able to say better if it is a poem or not. So that is one thing. So we can
I think it is free verse. It's blank verse and it is poetic. And there are little poems interspersed throughout the novel, and they are all very nice and very deep. Some of them are so haunting. That's what a poem is supposed to do. It's supposed to haunt you. The lines are supposed to ring through in your head, and that's what it does. So it is definitely poetry. So don't worry about it. It's not prose. It's definitely poetry.
I've done a poet. So, Gautam, are you coming out of your cocoon? Hi, Gautam. Anyways, Danya, so anything?
I have one question to you, Aunty, actually. Like we have read and all, there has been longer times where women in India were more empowered, much better than what we are today. And let's say Indian life started around maybe 7th century BC, and like people started settling down in India then, and this culture of oppressing women came only around 10th or 12th century ADs and stuff. Why are we not able to tap into that? You know, why are women today not, why are we still following these short-sighted and, you know, very recent developments than tapping into our actual way of life? Why are we still like this? I'm not sure if this is a question of just a ramble from today's women.
No, it is an like anxious expression. Yeah. I used to also ask the same thing. But the problem, can I answer this question, Jayanti?
Yeah.
You talked about the temple women. There is a tradition of temple women in Egypt, exact same type of clothing, just bare, thin, see-through clothes, and they same thing in Greece. You have lots of women. And the Romans actually picked up from the Greek culture, and India had connections with Greece before Rome. So all these traditions, when I went to Egypt, what I saw was this 5,000 years old temples, and the priests have one cloth around their waist, just like our dhoti, exactly like that. And they have the kudumi, that kind of thing. So I'm partial to the concept that, yes, these traditions all stem from one source, possibly India. I'm partial to that. Even the Rig Veda, everything Persian, you know, from there it sourced, and the Indus Valley civilization came out of there. So if you think about Mesopotamia, it spread this way and it spread the other way. So from when it spread the other way, similar roots. And if we are going to go back to our roots, what we are trying to do, you know, like for example, what this young Sadev Kumar is trying to do also is to understand how people read and understand the old literature or new literature, whatever, that helps. And for us, like, you know, like the kind of research Jayanti is doing, the kind of research you did trying to come up with this webinar thing, all of these things are going to feed into it. But again, it is unlimited. But the problem is what I discussed with Jayanti earlier when we were doing some interview about how the British thing, that was the worst hit of all, the deepest cut of all was that. But before that, the Islamic, at least it was 50-50. They tried to, you know, share their tradition and absorb our tradition. There was an amalgamation. There was a bit of a give and take. But the British was categorically, you know, Macaulay's, everybody is aware of the Macaulay's report. We'll break the big backbone of this culture by making them ashamed of their culture and making them ashamed of their educational system. And they completely erased history, the actual true history, very pointedly destroyed many libraries. Alexandria was burnt up, so many, you know, Nalanda University was burnt, so many things were lost. And Rome has the biggest vaults under its the papal thing, and they have the text. If they're not valuable, if they're not one wonderful information, that should be, knowledge should be free. But these people are trying to control knowledge, and they have the world's biggest archive of literature from around the world. Wherever they went, they took it, and it is being held back from public to keep us dumbed down. And I mean, I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but there is so much evidence that points that way, because I have been teaching in UK and I have seen that they don't know their own culture. They know only.
There's been some issue today, right?
Yes.
The answer is that yes, there is very planned suppression of information. We are fed misinformation in this world of information technology. We are actually being fed with.
I can continue a bit on that. She has gone broad in the broader sense. I'm going inside. Britishers not only looted our wealth in the physical sense, that wealth, they crushed the culture. That's what they have done. And now for us to go back is really difficult, because we are neither here nor there. We are westernized, so-called westernized. So what happens is we have started thinking like a western brain, and therefore we cannot possibly go to that culture that we had, the rich culture that we really had. So it's impossible to even think. We can only imitate what was there then. And some places I can see certain imitations going on. When people came to know that I'm doing research on Devadasi system, 2-3 people came to me to ask for interviewing and all that. And they started explaining our temple we are trying to, you know, bring back the system of temple women, this, that, 2-3 groups. I wouldn't take the name of those names of the groups, but it was interesting for me. It happened, and it was, I told them it's impossible for you to bring that system back. It was not as you think it was. Because even today, if you're going to bring back the system, you may have lots of flowers, lots of jewelry and all Kanchipuram and all you might have. But it wasn't that way at that time. So no. Impossible, almost impossible. We can only cherish what was there that time. We can appreciate, register as it was done in the novel. And Dhanya said we are able to appreciate the history through the novel more
if it was a book, it wouldn't be.
Aren't we to continue with my question? Aren't we actually going back to our own system in the name of westernization? Actually, we are again going into empowering women and not controlling women's clothes. And are women getting more educated and women earning money and them having their own places and all? Aren't we going back to the actual Indian culture just in a different way?
In a way, yes. A modified variation of it only you can say. It cannot be that way, exactly that way. It cannot be because their life was more so one with nature. And we are so much away from the nature and don't even have to talk about the gadgets and the technology that we are so used to. Those things are there. No, coming to the point you made that reading history through fiction is so different from reading history as textbook. Generally, they say when you want to teach students, they will read it better. I mean, they will grasp it better through stories. And obviously, we're all like that. And so when it is given in a story form, although each era was in images only, it was not a full-fledged lifestyle in that era. The idea was to give the
flavor of it.
Development and fall. So that much I could do. But if I were to write only on those temple women without touching the contemporary, is also possible. Such a novel is possible. But I didn't want it that way. Anyone can write like that. I wanted something that the present day readers can really, they will have something to take also, and they like many readers are drawing parallels between the contemporary and the ancient thread now after reading the fiction, and that experience also must come. I took that as a challenge for myself, and I love doing that, and the experience stays with me.
Can I just add to what Tanya was saying? Are we not going back? Yes, we are. At the same time, we are not, because we can only come up with a new ways of being compared to what was in the Vedic times. In the Vedic times, the women were empowered to the level that they were masters and of having debates and discussions with the big heads of states and everything. And so it is, and they were acharyas, all, women acharyas were there. They were teachers of great intelligence, and I think with the computer technology, we can use that to our advantage to spread the message. That is what I think. Young people are so hooked into that. Okay, give them the good stuff through that. That is one way. I don't know. Maybe I'm talking idealistically, but there is one way to get them.
No, we humans. We have become too self-centered. Those times, it was always for the greater good. That one point is missing in today's world. And that is going to hinder us in going back to that golden era, if you want to say. Because human mind, is so self-centered these days in the modern world. It's impossible to think like them. We may dress like them. We may do the rituals like them. We may chant like them. We may stop using the gadgets and the technology. Okay, I'm going to sit in the temple. Maybe, yes, okay, fine. But when are you going to learn to think for the greater good? It will take at least 10 generations probably in the genes for the transformation to happen, and it's almost near impossible. Gautam, you won't show your face today. Gautam Sashidharan.
Sabdev,
you have Sabdev, you can ask anything if you wish to. I can't hear you.
You're muted. Can you unmute your audio?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a question to Danya.
Yes.
Danya, she's okay. Danya.
Okay, Danya. Okay. Sri Danya. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Instead, you were mentioning, you mentioned about, you know, a Kathak, okay, which has a strong influence of Indian and Persian influence. Okay, I would like to know about Odissi as well. Okay. Mm. Is there like a connection, you know, between Odissi dance and the depiction of, you know, of women, you know, as sculptures in temple? Because like from what I observe, okay, when it comes to Odissi dance, you know, the techniques and the, you know, and the movements, okay, are very much, you know, inclined, you know, with the different Indian art forms. So is there like any connection, you know, between...
Yes. Yeah. This Tribhanga that I was talking to you about, that is most pronounced in Odissi than in any other classical dance form of India. Tribhanga is, at least in Bharatanatyam, that is a pose. Like you will transition from one pose to another and you will make this, but the entire dance of Odissi will be done in a Tribhanga posture itself. This temple women, though misplaced heads talks, it spans only around Tamil Nadu and Malaysia. Maybe Bharatanatyam has been more focused on, but I'm sure through India, wherever there was, let's not call it Hinduism, because I don't think Hinduism by itself is a religion.
Yeah.
Sanatana Dharma, wherever it was followed throughout India, this must have been, practiced. There is a chance of it happening. I do not have any documented information from where I read this, but this is just my interpretation that this must have happened. And if you look at Odissi jewelry, usually in dance forms, the jewelries will reflect what was the resource of that area. Odissi, usually the jewelry, if you look, it will be mostly of silver. It will not be of gold like there and like for us in Bharatanatyam.
It's made of pith is the central stalk of a plant, and you take it and cut it, and it's mostly made of pith, and it is local, as you said. It's very, very locally sourced product, not any fancy from outside imported source. Yes.
And all these classical dance forms, when they were danced, when they were first introduced, they were not classical forms. They were all tribal forms that this culture has taken inside. It was not, the culture did not bring in the dances. The culture has taken all these dances from different parts to inside it. So they must have some connection. And Odisha, like all of us know, it is a coastal state. So there's a high chance of it having trade with the other countries. So there must have, if we say they can come to Tamil Nadu, if the Greeks could come to Tamil Nadu, I'm sure they could have gone to Odisha.
There
must be a huge connection to Kerala, because Kerala was the first place that any Arab country or anywhere from the west people would have landed. There should have been.
The first connection must
have been to Kerala.
Coming to Odissi, Odissi comes under Lasya. Lasya is the graceful form of dance. Odissi is one form that comes under Lasya. There are other forms of dance as well. Like those northeastern states, they have very simple movements. Those tribes, again, like she said, tribal dances, very simple swinging of the hip movements. And Odissi, yes. Odissi, as she said, it's mostly Tribhanga, and it's a swaying movement of Odissi is about. Coming to Kerala, the trade was very flourishing. Any trade ship or any sail will touch Kerala and then only go on to other. And the main attraction was pepper, black pepper, which went as far as England, and Kerala was the center for pepper, no? Very long back, even 10 centuries back. And interestingly, the first Jew settlement was in Kerala. It seems outside Israel.
Was in Muziris,
Goa, right? Goa and Kerala.
Muziris, Goa later on. Kerala the first. Those are the things. Anything else we can discuss? Today's two speeches were remarkable.
Thank you.
I mean, distinctly dense and very nice. So
yes.
So we have so less to discuss, probably. Huh? Yes.
Murali sir, you have any questions? He's refraining from himself from questioning our talk.
His face. And and Gautam started following him. So
Miss Jayanti.
Yes.
Yeah. So let's say, you know, if there were movie rights, to adapt your novel, into a movie.
Yeah.
Will you allow it? Because from the way I see, Sri Danya, Usha, and the way both of you explained today, I see that how nice if this book could be adapted into a movie and could be an eye opener for everyone out there to know more about this Devadasis.
Yeah, it is really properly taken, there are two main threats, ancient and the contemporary. If they are really properly taken and really edited properly, mixed well, it can really become a visual treat.
Beautiful.
Yes. Undoubtedly. But again, I have signed a contract with my publisher. Oh. If there is any visual adaptation or translation or anything, it will be through them. And I don't mind. I mean, it's not. But do you know anyone? I was just asking.
Oh, okay. Because in Malaysia we have I'm sure you all know Dato' Ramli Ibrahim. He's a very famous Odissi dancer in Malaysia. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering, maybe he can do something because he's very much into.
I have read one extensive interview by Mr. Ibrahim, right? Very nice dancer.
Ramli Ibrahim, dancer.
Yes.
Yeah, very creative, yeah.
Very passionate, I know.
Yes.
And when you're giving me your address, maybe you can give his address also. I can send Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, no problem. Yeah. So I can find out, ma'am, maybe next year, when this COVID thing is over, then I can find out, if there is what you mentioned about, having your book to be turned out into a movie. So maybe we can...
If you are going to refer me to a movie maker, of course I will be glad. I'll be happy to discuss. But I will have Rukmini Vijayakumar for Tanya and Shobana for my Purna.
I'm sure there'll be something will turn out, because I see
people,
I want
Rukmini Vijayakumar for Vaitanya and Shobana
Shobana
Purna.
Shobana for Purna, and who's Tanya?
Rukmini.
Tanya will be Rukmini Vijayakumar.
Oh my God, Rukmini.
Okay. I'm just wishful thinking. Let's talk something about the novel, or we can wrap.
Yes.
Any more questions?
Anything else? Are we going to talk, or we can
next week some more?
Or what I do, I will just wrap up and stop the recording, and we can just casually chat.
Yes.
So thank you, Usha and Danya, for such a lovely participation as speakers. And I must thank Sabdev Kumar for genuine participation as well. And the silent, silent but very, very genuine Gautam and Muralidharan. Can't miss them both. Thank you very much. We will meet next week. It was brilliant today in a different way compared to the last two. They were differently nice, and today it was really good. Thank you so much.